Let's take a look now at the idea of calculating sample size. We looked at calculating sample sizes when we're going to go collect data to calculate a proportion. So what if we're going to need a sample size that we can go out and calculate a mean? So we want to do inferences for mu based on x bar. Well, remember before I said this is the margin of error. And we'll do the exact same thing we did with proportions. Simply solve for n, and this is what we get. Now, there are a couple of problems in this calculation. There are two major problems. The first one is S. S is the sample standard deviation. So how can we have the sample standard deviation if we don't have data yet? That's kind of the chicken or the egg sort of thing. It's a circular argument again. The other is T. Remember, T is a family of curves based on the degrees of freedom. And the degrees of freedom is n minus 1. So right there is our sample size. So t depends on the sample size. But you can't find t until you have the sample size, but you're trying to find the sample size so that you can, you see what I'm saying? Already it gets confusing as I'll get out. So this is what we do. This is where we salvage this situation. Knowing that the z and t are very close to each other, we change this to n equals z of alpha over 2. And then we have s over the margin of error squared. Well, s is still a problem. We still need to come up with a way to estimate s. And that's exactly what we're going to do. Now, very commonly as a consultant, the first question I'm asked is, what sample size do I need? And what I typically ask them is, you know, what do you know about the process to begin with? Now, assuming normality, just for sake of initial calculations, I know if I go out one, two standard deviations, this is going to have about 95% of all my data based on the empirical rule, right? So anything beyond that, anything beyond two standard deviations, we start to think of as being unusual. So I will ask the person or whoever I'm working with, what do you realistically think the lowest value and the highest value would be? So then they will end up giving me a value that they think is the low and a value they think is the high. So if I take the high minus the low, divide it by 4, because there's 1, 2, 3, 4 standard deviations in here, this will give me a rough estimate for sigma. So the sample size calculation will be very, very sensitive to these two estimates. If these values are way off, then the sample size estimate is going to be way off, and I simply make any client very, very clear of that. So some knowledge of the process would be required to begin with. Now, absent that knowledge, you could use an iterative process. It's not as desirable, but you could do it. In other words, say, all right, let's just go out and take a sample of 30. And based on that 30, find out what the margin of error is, because we could then find S. We know N is 30. We know what this value is. We can calculate the margin of error. And if that margin of error is too big, then we can start adding, go get more data, adding until we get a margin of error that is within reason. Now, this is not the greatest method in the world, nor is the idea here of estimating the high and the low. It's very sensitive to the high and low estimate. It's very sensitive to actual data that you collected. But absent anything else, it's about the best that you can do. Something you need to make sure you really understand about data analysis is that the mathematics is exact. Doing this sort of thing is exact. Finding the confidence interval is exact. The application is not. We do a lot of estimation because, quite frankly, that's the best that we can do. So, looking at this information, I know that the margin of error has to be no more than 1.5. with 95% certainty, so alpha is 0.05. And what I need is an estimate for sigma. Well, this is the average time student spends outside of class each week studying for this particular class. Well, realistically, I could have somebody as high as maybe 12 hours. That's just a rough estimate. And I would hope that nobody would be less than, say, 4 hours. Yeah, but you know that four may be pretty optimistic. Just because I would hope that there's nobody that spends less than four, that doesn't mean that they do. There's certainly going to be people that put in like no more than 1 or 2 hours. Let's say 1 hour. And then if I divide that by four, what I end up with 11 divided by four, which is 2.75. So now I have my estimates here. So if I jump over to TC Stats, select analysis methods without data, or actually it doesn't matter, I can select my data. Sample size calculation is what I want. And this time it's for mu, and this is actually the formula I'm using. The margin of error we said was 1.5. The estimate for sigma we said was 2.75. And the significance level, alpha, was 0.05. So this is saying I need 12.91, which in reality means at least 13. So if this is a reasonable estimate to begin with, then I only need a sample size of 13 to have a margin of error no bigger than 1.5. However, once again, if this estimate is way off, then my margin of error will also be way off. And just for the fun of it, let's see what happens if I take this the estimate for sigma. Let's say it was closer to 5. What would that do to the sample size? Makes it jump. Makes it jump from 13 to 43, basically. So what if the standard deviation was as high as, say, 8? See, the sample size start jumping and jumping and jumping. Because remember, this margin of error will look like the value of t, alpha over 2 on the appropriate degrees of freedom, s over the square root of n. So as s gets bigger and bigger, standard deviation gets bigger and bigger, which is the estimate for sigma. The only way to keep the margin of error small is if I increase the sample size. So mathematically, it makes sense.